Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Graduation Equity Webinar Series. I'm Kefi Andersen. I'm a System Improvement Program Supervisor Lead. Today, we are going to talk about Tier 2 Solutions for Student Well-Being. This meeting is being recorded, and it should be available in the next couple of days on YouTube. We do have closed captioning and American Sign Language interpretation today. So if you are interested, you can look at the menu for captions. Our PowerPoint is also available on our webinar page on the OSPI website. And we'll also have a resource sheet and the slides available for you in the chat if you're interested in that. And we've gotten some feedback from you that you're curious about who's attending these with you. So if you'd like to share your name, your role, your district, or get the conversation started, maybe with something that you're curious about today, go for it. This webinar is brought to you through the Office of Student Engagement and Supports at OSPI. At OSPI, we believe each student needs to be prepared for post-secondary pathways, careers, and civic engagement. Our webinar series was created with the purpose of highlighting practices that increase access to education and graduation. Through the webinar, we are striving to think critically about historical contexts and the opportunities that we have to get curious about and dismantle policies and practices that don't serve our youth. We want to make it possible for each student to have access to the instruction and the support that will make them successful in school and in life. The Pacific Northwest is a really beautiful place in the autumn, and I know my neighborhood, we're seeing leaves falling and it's starting to get chilly outside. And we ask that the participants of this meeting honor the traditional lands on which each of you are located today. In my life, I mostly travel around the intersection of the traditional lands of the Squaxin Island, the Coast Salish, the Cowlitz, and the Nisqually tribes. I'd like to acknowledge the Indigenous people who have stewarded this land since time immemorial and who still live here today. We want to encourage you to take part in tribal consultation. It's a good way to get to know your local tribes and to help the students in your neighborhoods. The reason that we're choosing to talk about Tier 2 supports is that we know not every student is getting what they need. No one's perfect. I know that for myself. I remember being really depressed as a teenager and not knowing what to do about it or who to ask. And it would have been helpful to have a support group or a neutral adult to talk to about what was happening in my life and just to help me navigate what healthy relationships could look like. We know that schools are busy places and that sometimes tiered supports can be challenging. There's a lot of personalization needed to make them fit a specific school. And it's really easy to forget about Tier 2 and focus on Tier 1 and Tier 3. So we want to help schools navigate what Tier 2 can look like and inspire your practices and encourage you to lean into them as a preventative strategy that can be led with a team approach. By participating in the webinar, we hope you get a chance to understand high leverage Tier 2 foundational supports and implementation, that you get ideas for your staffing and structuring that will help scaffold those supports, that you can learn from some experiences implementing Tier 2 from our panel, and we'll get you some resources to get you started. I'm joined today by my OSPI colleagues. Nikki York is our school social worker and behavioral health program supervisor. And Christian Stark is our behavioral health and suicide prevention program supervisor. Both Nikki and Christian are really awesome resources to tap into at OSPI. So if you're interested in learning more about those supports, they are the ones to talk to. They brought with them Rachel Barrett. Rachel is a licensed clinical social worker and joins the UW Smart Center as the program manager for the workforce for student well-being following 20 plus years in schools, community mental health, and out-of-district placements for students with significant mental health needs. Rachel provides consultation to schools, teaches children's mental health content at the UW School of Social Work, and supports the professional development of the next generation social workers. She is coming with her partner. Debbie Limon is a certified special education teacher who has worked in multiple districts in the greater Seattle area as a teacher, a program specialist, an instructional coach, and a behavioral consultant. For the past 10 years, she's been supporting teams in systems work and breaking down silos in service of inclusion, including a year-long role on the OSPI MTSS implementation team. This July, she started a professional consulting conglomerate called Tier Tools. And we'll also have a panel of practitioners later on that I'll introduce a little bit later. We'd like to get to know our audience, so I'm going to launch a poll here, and we are going to find out who's here. And then while you guys are doing that, I just want to put in a word for if you have questions throughout our presentation today, please use our Q&A. Jocelyn is looking at those questions, and you can also upvote questions. So if there's a question in there that you really want to have answered, you can add that as well in the Q&A. The chat, we would love to see your comments. It's great to see so many people here today. And Ronnie has also just dropped our resource page in the chat as well as the presentation. So if you want a copy of the slides, if you want the resource page, they are there, and we'll try to drop those in kind of periodically today so that people can get them. And it looks like today we have quite a few school counselors, counselor psych, community liaisons, that type of position. We also have quite a few administrators and district office staff with us, and lots of people who are kind of in the middle or high school realm or in both. And people already feel somewhat familiar about our topic today. So I'm going to end that poll. Thank you for participating. And we're gonna go over to Christian to look at Washington's data.
Thank you so much, Kefi, and it's great to be here. I'm grateful to be with so many great presenters today and so many folks who are working with students in schools. As Kefi mentioned, I'm on our behavioral health and suicide prevention team at OSPI. And I just wanted to give a little bit of context this morning on what students are telling us their needs are around mental health as we work into a focus on tier two mental health supports specifically today. So this is data from the Healthy Youth Survey. I'm sure many of you are familiar with this data set. It's a every other year survey. So the last time it was taken was in 2021. It now is taken on in odd years since COVID. Actually, I misspoke. The last time it was taken was last month. So we're going to have the 2023 Healthy Youth Survey data, hopefully by this spring. We'll be interested to see kind of what these things look like, but for now, we'll share some information about what students told us in 2021 their needs were around mental health. So you can see on the screen, this is data for 10th graders. The data set includes over 200,000 200,000 students across the state, so a good number of our students across the state. Of those 10th graders that were surveyed, 70% said that they felt nervous or anxious in the past 2 weeks at some point in the previous year. More than 50% of students said they were unable to stop or control worrying in the past 2 weeks at some point in the past year. Over a third of students said that they felt sad or hopeless at some point in the past year. As we move further along the screen here, we see this need indicated in our suicidality data as well. 20% of 10th grade students surveyed said that they considered attempting suicide in the past year. 16% of students said that they made a plan to commit suicide in the past year. And 8% of students attempted suicide in the past year. So these are shocking numbers. I'm sure many of you have personal stories about what this need looks like in your schools, but it's clear to us and to everyone, I'm sure, across the state that we're in a mental health crisis. Students are experiencing urgent need, and it's so important that we as a system work together to support students that have these needs. The last piece on the screen here that I wanted to highlight is we know from this survey that 15% of students said that they did not feel like they had an adult to turn to when they felt sad or hopeless. Today, I'm hopeful because we'll hear so many different ways that you all can support mental health need when you see it in your students. But I think my goal in sharing this information and all of our goals in kind of providing these supports should be to get that number as close to zero as possible so that when students experience mental health need, when they see need in themselves and in their peers, they have someone to go to in the school system or many someones to go to in the school system. I won't stay on this slide too long, but I just wanted to highlight briefly that even though the mental health indicator information I just shared was for 10th grade students, we see the same need demonstrated in our suicidality data for 8th, 10th, and 12th grade students. Again, just underlining how much need we're seeing across a large amount of age groups. And we're also hearing from younger students in middle school and sometimes even elementary school that are thinking about some of these difficult topics. And it's so important that we work to meet that need and encourage conversations about mental health and this kind of need in particular. The last bit of suicidality data I wanted to share is on the screen now. It's broken out by race and ethnicity, as well as gender and sexuality. It's also really important to note that this is an equity issue, that mental health need and suicidality vary based on the identities that our students bring with them into the school setting. You can see in particular on the left-hand side, over a third of our American Indian or Alaska Native students said that they contemplated suicide. When you're looking on the right side, you can see that almost 60% of transgender students said that they contemplated suicide in the previous year. And almost 50% of gay, lesbian, or bisexual students. So this is alarmingly high need, and we know that those students face additional challenges when we talk about belonging and being yourself in the school setting. And the more we can be adults that those students feel comfortable turning to when they have struggles, the better we'll be able to meet their needs. The last thing I wanted to share before I hand it over to my colleague, Nikki, is a little bit about multi-tiered systems of supports and specifically how OSPI supports work around multi-tiered systems of supports in school districts and in school buildings, many of the places you all work. You can see on the left-hand side there, Washington has their own MTSS framework. This is specifically talking about how we organize adults in the school system to support student need across, you know, all three tiers of supports that we'll talk a lot more today about tier two, but MTSS is a way of visualizing supports across all three of those tiers and ensuring that we support student need. That can be, you know, in academics, that could be in attendance and re-engagement, but again, specifically, we'll be talking about mental health supports today within that context. My last plug for them is, we have an awesome MTSS team at OSPI. If you'd like more information about the work that they do, feel free to visit their website that is linked right there on the page. Okay, I'm gonna hand it over to Nikki. Thank you all. It's great to be here with you this morning.
All
right. So I'm just going to talk briefly about the interconnected systems framework. And really, it's kind of a main staple for Washington schools and really across the nation. And at the bottom of the triangle, you'll see that there's home and community. And this bottom section is talking about how we as a society can improve mental health. And that's really through destigmatizing and increasing mental health awareness and training. Talking about mental health normal is really the keystone of that. And I think that when we look back at COVID, we can recognize how that actually helped us acknowledge the need for mental health supports. Then at tier one, that's really universal protection and screenings. And that includes social emotional learning. It teaches students how to manage their behavior. And this is something that everyone from principal to custodian are talking about together. And the students should be seeing this as a united front. Tier two is for students who might be struggling. So in your role, you might notice that some students are struggling and you can identify them and you can help determine how to get them support. And often at this tier, it's things like a group support. They might need additional structure after school or even just individual connection with a trusted adult. And everyone in the school can do tier two work if they are trained. And then finally, tier three is working with students individually and with their families, possibly referring them to community-based providers to support them with their mental health needs. And this could also include telehealth, especially as we see the rise in telehealth services since COVID. And we see that a lot in our rural communities too, is utilizing that as a strategy. And then we're just going to go just a tiny bit deeper to this information. And what this slide really highlights is the different staff that can deliver services at each tier. So again, with tier one, this is something that everyone can do. Next is tier two. And again, everyone can do tier two if they are trained. And then finally, tier three is professional experts. And the main thing that I really want to call out on this slide is that you'll see that ESA staff are represented at each tier. So ESA staff or educational support associates have a role at tier one, tier two, and tier three. Okay, so I'm going to talk just a little bit about why we're talking about mental health in schools. And this is really about the case for school mental health. And what we know is that school mental health is supporting mental health in schools is associated with positive mental health outcomes for children and youth. Research shows that schools are the most common place for young people to seek and receive mental health services. School-based social emotional learning and strong systems help to promote a positive school culture and actually improve academic outcomes. And school mental health services are essential to ensuring that our schools are safe. The other thing I want to note is that school is also where our racially diverse students are most likely to access care, so it creates equity and access to these services. So how is OSPI supporting this work? This by no means is a comprehensive list of all the work that we are doing, but we did want to highlight a few things. The first one is that the coordination with regional behavioral health navigators and University of Washington Forefront Suicide Prevention. We also work with Lifeline's suicide prevention, intervention, and postvention curriculum. Updating and sharing the model plan template for student social, emotional, behavioral, and mental health recognition, screening, and response. And then finally, supporting the University of Washington Smart Center's Workforce for Student Wellness or Wellbeing initiative, which is where they are working to train the next generation of school social workers to be able to deliver evidence-based practices to support students in schools. And then the last thing I want to talk about is just also noting that You know, of course, we have to fund these positions that we're talking about. And so the legislature, recognizing a need to increase the funding for these services, did pass the House Bill 1664. And that actually started with last school year. And this provides additional funding to school districts by increasing the minimum allocations for nurses, social workers, psychologists, and counselors, and the prototypical school funding model. And it goes for multiple years. So you can look down, the numbers are at the bottom, and you can see how much money is being invested by the state each year. So this school year, we're looking at over $230 million to increase these roles in schools. And it's really looking at support roles like the ESA roles that are listed here, the nurses, social workers, psychologists, and counselors, but also any staff that really supports the social emotional health of our students. And we're hoping that this increase in funding translates into additional service capacity so more students can be served. And with that, I think that's my last slide.
Yeah, awesome. Thank you, Nikki and Christian. Next, we're going to go over to Debbie and Rachel to give us some tier two ideas. So, you're up.
Thank you. We're really happy to be here today. Today, we will not be giving step-by-step directions for implementation, but rather we'll be explaining the importance of Tier 2, how to plan for and shift quickly into Tier 2, and we'll be giving examples of resource allocation and design of Tier 2, as well as examples of Tier 2 interventions. We're kind of considering this the what, why, and how in these first few slides. So this is the what of Tier 2. Supports are provided to some students, and they're clearly defined in advance of needing them. Intervening prior to catastrophe often means a need to be able to intervene with intention and as soon as data and evidence of need arise. This also requires quick decision making and having decision rules determined in advance. Formalized and marketed means that the process and procedures are written and promoted to staff through training and perpetual PR or public relations. I like to say that I'm a tiered intervention publicist. Decision rules means that the parameters for moving students in and out and between interventions are predetermined and written into the process and procedures. This enables teams to make more confident and quick decisions that are less subjective. These tier two supports can be provided in small group or individually. They can be embedded into the classroom. Tier two instruction that is needed by some students can be embedded into universal instruction to collaterally benefit all students. They use evidence-based interventions, or it's important to use evidence-based interventions. Collaborative means working together to align interventions and therefore compound the benefits of each professional approach. And as always, we need to have progress monitoring, which is data collected to continually return to those decision rules, as well as becoming support of evidence-based practices, because if the data is showing progress, then that is an evidence-based practice for your community. This slide kind of delves into the why of Tier 2 supports. As Christian explained, there's an increased need for mental health supports for students. Early intervention can prevent problems from escalating and becoming more severe, making it easier to address those issues effectively earlier. Supports must be matched to need. Although Tier 2 is not individualized, it is customized. Data is used to determine need for mental health and for academics. For academic, we wouldn't want to be providing decoding instruction for challenges with reading comprehension. And similarly, interventions for mental health and social emotional should be chosen to match need. An example is if a family and student survey highlighted that there's a feeling of lack of safety at recess, And the universal social skills curriculum delivered as tier one instruction is focused on mindfulness, then the data is showing that the intervention is not matching the social emotional need. Chosen interventions, although readily available, should be decided selectively. Improved academic and social outcomes. Since academics is closely tied to mental health, with the correct interventions, we'll see improvements in both. Decrease in need for more intensive resources. As we've mentioned, staving off the need for more intensive supports allows those resources to be provided to those with the greatest need and where they have the most impact. Predetermined decision rules improve timelines and equity and improve school climate. Data-driven decision-making improves team collaboration in determining interventions and educator confidence in making those decisions in a timely manner. Decreases in delay in providing services when needed. It improves equity in ensuring that students are moving in and out of intervention-based community and team design guidelines. Team design guidelines include recruiting input of community and family through pointed engagement and inclusion in team that are implemented in creating tier two supports. An example of recruiting information and using that data to start with what you have would be to survey what adults in the community are trusted. Who are the adults that students already feel comfortable and confident in going to for advice and support, and formalizing and building structures around those relationships that exist. Self-evaluation and continuous improvement. Teams look at what is working and effective and make team-based data-driven decisions regarding the systems for implementation of tiered supports. This delves into the how of tier two. Again, we would like to start with that resource inventory. We believe that when strengthening tier two, you should start with what you have and use what you got. Survey the resources available and create a flow chart for those resources. Team inquiry. When building a decision-making implementation team, make sure that the purpose of the team is clear, there's diverse representation of membership, and that agreed goals and outcome aims are made transparent. When looking at building this team and surveying resources, include sustainable resources, meaning the school psychology intern might have the capacity to take on tasks for this team, but this is not a sustainable team role. Needs assessment and data collection. Conduct a needs assessment by gathering data that is already being collected and planning for data that needs to be collected. So looking at what you're already pulling in, already doing the work for, and then making a plan around the holes or what else needs to be collected. Data that's already being collected likely includes office discipline referrals, guidance team referral data, and possibly screening data. An example that I have is this week I was working with a newly formed implementation team to complete a fidelity measure. And they candidly shared with me that they were concerned about where the time to do this was going to come from. And we talked about systems that they currently have in place. And this has included a behavior team that was collecting school safety data, student tracking data, behavior incident reports, and student developmental data, but that there was no one looking at that data globally for building-wide database decisions outside of the team that was just looking at the individual student data for individual student decisions. They agreed that using the data that was already being collected would feel not only doable, but it would also be an important implementation team function that would improve morale because it would make work that is already being done more useful. Along those lines, we have linked a resource here for using data to choose interventions, including choosing a social emotional learning curriculum based on the needs that are showing up in the data. There's a link to CASEL here. That's collaborative for academic and social and emotional learning. And this is a guide for helping teams choose a social emotional learning curriculum.
All right. Rachel? Yes. Good morning, everybody. Wouldn't you know, my internet just said it was unstable, right? When I'm talking to 300 of my closest friends. So if I freeze, I hope it's in a really attractive way, and Debbie will let me know I'm frozen. So Debbie and I are so excited to be here talking with you today. We did some really great work together as tier two and three behavioral and mental health consultants. And as we put this presentation together, we were reflecting on what was it that made some of our work more versus less effective. And as we looked at that, this is sort of the who of tier two supports. We found that in our experience, the most effective interventions had really effective, often cross-disciplinary collaboration. We've been involved in tier two interventions with all kinds of staff. And like Debbie mentioned, you know, what's an important place to start is to look at who has the strongest relationships with the students that you're targeting. So those could be all kinds of staff in your school setting. As Nikki mentioned, ESAs work across the tiers. So you could have lots of different ESA folks supporting your work with your students. Now, I'm a little biased because I am a school social worker. I did want to make a quick plug for hiring school social workers when you can. It was exciting to see some of that Nikki's slide about the funding resources. School social workers, when they land in your school, they have a unique framework that they're trained in their graduate programs. The fancy term is person and environment. And what it means is that we're trained to look at every person as being influenced by the environment around them, which lends itself really easily to that sort of systemic view of what looks like an individual problem. So if you are thinking about who to sort of add to your staffing team to enhance tier two supports, I'd suggest looking at ESAs and even considering school social workers. If you're interested in learning more about the workforce for student well-being, I believe that that website is in your resource list. If you get a workforce for student well-being student or social worker, you're getting someone with extra training and implementation of MTSS systems of support.
Thank you. Now we're going to go into a few examples of resource allocation and the decisions around that. I'm often asked questions like, how should small districts use the resources, or what should mid-sized rural districts do? And no two districts or schools have the same resources or building blocks. And this is why we can't provide formulaic blueprints, but we can provide guidance. Designing with known resources reminds me of an application that is currently available for iPhones and Androids called Brickit. And this is an application that's used with your pile of Legos that you have. You can dump out your Legos and take a picture on the app, and it will give you ideas about what structures you can build with the bricks that you have. Districts can and should be compiling their resources and aligning them with the data collected in their needs assessment. Here are two examples of assessment and resource allocations for districts. If we look at District A, they're working with an outside agency that provides mental health specialists and support individually for students in their school community. And the district benefits from these resources. However, they have less discretion with how they can use those services. So they cannot use those services for small group instruction. And because of that, the district reflected and decided that they really wanted to target remaining resources that they have and funding to use for a universal social emotional learning curriculum and training staff and delivering that curriculum with fidelity. And those are two kind of matching resources that they've paired together. And if we look at District B, they saw a significant increase in incident reports at recess in their data, especially during competitive games. They completed a universal screening tool that highlighted that students did not feel safe at recess, mostly because of competitive games. And they implemented their decision based on that data for resource allocation was they implemented a 6-week social emotional learning booster program where their talented physical education teacher retaught rules for recess, had a vision for doing a unit on non-competitive games. And they had that resource available through looking at the skills of their physical education teacher. And that's how they matched resources to need in their community. The tier two is built with the needs and resources of each local district. We look at the local ecology. In the examples of these two districts, one was partnering with a community-based mental health agency and their services, they were using it, and the other had services through the PE teacher and was using a universal screening tool. At this time, we invite you to put in the chat resources that are in your community. For example, mental health specialists that you partner with, community-based organizations that you partner with, or possibly you're using universal screening tools. Especially put resources that you think might be unique to your local community regarding staff roles, community partnerships, and those family connections. We invite you to put your unique resources in the chat. Oh, I see a clothing bank. That's fantastic. Wow, these are coming fast and swift. A lot of community and schools, a lot of partners with mental health agencies and resources for food and clothing. These are fantastic. And these are unique to your local community, although there is a lot of overlap, I see.
Great. Should we move on? Okay, here we go. All right. So this slide isn't here just to make you hungry. This is a metaphor that Debbie and I were thinking through, kind of what are the differences between when we would do a tier two versus a tier three intervention in a school. So if you think of tiered support, you're sort of thinking of selecting a restaurant. So on one side, you have the kids menu, which is where you order off the menu and you're getting things fast, right? So it's a quick order restaurant. They only make a few things and they make them the same way. And you're going to get that food quickly. And that's a way to think about tier two, because tier two ideally should be delivered within, I think it's 72 hours of referral. So you want to be able to get what the student needs quickly. You want, like this restaurant, you're going to get what you need right away. Now, when you order a tier two intervention off the menu, you can still customize it a little bit. Like Debbie mentioned earlier, tier two interventions are still adaptable and customizable. They're not just super individualized and staff intensive like tier three supports. So for example, if you order off this kids menu, you could say, I want to split the plate. If you're going to a restaurant with my children, you need to smother everything in ketchup. It doesn't matter what you order, you just pour disgusting amounts of ketchup on top. So I'm still adapting what they're ordering, but I'm still getting something off the menu. So that could be like, if you have an evidence-based small group intervention, you need to adapt it developmentally for who the kids are in the group. So maybe you're adjusting the pacing of the delivery, but you're still pulling that same intervention off the menu. But you can't go to that kids menu restaurant and say, I would like your finest vegetable soup, but can you hand pick out all of the mushrooms because mushrooms are gross? And I will stand by that because I do think mushrooms are gross. There's no amount of ketchup that makes mushrooms better. Now, if you were instead to go to the tier three restaurant, the build your own bowl and burrito, you're going to get exactly what you want, exactly to your taste, but it's going to take a little bit longer. So when you go to that restaurant, there might be a longer line. When you go to that restaurant, it might be that all the seats in the restaurant are full and you have to wait until someone leaves for you to get your spot. So you know, you when you're picking between two tier two and tier three, you're picking something quick to order right off the menu that you can adapt, or you're picking something that you're going to have to wait because it's more staff or kitchen intensive, but it's going to be exactly what you're looking for. So when you're thinking about what's on your menu, you have to do some resource mapping. So I hope that there weren't folks who came here today saying, I'm going to leave and know exactly who to do all of my tier two supports, exactly what things I need to be implementing for tier two. It's a little bit more complex than that because everybody's coming from such different local ecologies with different resources available to them. So our suggestion is that you start with some resource mapping to see what's on your menu. So you might, for example, already have a really great co-taught or co-supported language arts class at your high school. And that could be a tier two support. You just need to sort of systematize who gets spots in that class, how you decide who would benefit from it. I had a referral for a student with some significant needs at an elementary school. And when I was observing at recess, there was a recess monitor who all the kids loved. Recess monitors are the unsung heroes of all elementary schools. And she had what I consider to be a tier two intervention that she was implementing. She would take certain kids that were real squirrely and had a lot of trouble with that transition from recess time to classroom time, and she would help them find all of the balls at recess and collect them. And I don't know how it's physically possible for elementary students to get balls into every single corner of a playground, but they do. So she benefited from them helping collect them. And then they would count the number of balls and report it to the front office. And it was such a great tier two intervention that they just needed to systematize a little bit for her to think, how many of these kind of squirrely kids can I take for this transition period? How do we identify which kids would benefit from this? And then that became something that was on their menu. So when you look at this slide, there's a lot of different options that may or may not be familiar to you. We have individual or group instruction, and that would be very brief counseling that's a little bit more skills focused. Support groups or therapeutic groups. Check in, check out is a great tier two intervention. Something that's more relationship enhancement focused, like check in, connect or 2x10, briefcase management. I really want to call in that family and caregiver support. I think tier two intervention should also be aimed at engaging and partnering with our families. So this is a great time to sort of pause and for you to think about your home district and ecology and what are some intervention examples that are on the menu at your school that you would want to share in the chat. They could be ones that you see on the slide. It could be more kind of unique ones that you see in your school community. But let's hear from folks about what they're already doing on the menu. Oh, I see affinity spaces. That's really helpful. Mentoring opportunities. Check and check out. A class pass. Great. Whew, they're flying in. And you can see that there's not like one list that every single school is doing the exact same thing. We're all figuring out what works for our school and our community. And hopefully, as you look through the list in the chat, you might see some things that pique your interest and you're thinking, that's one that I want to try. I want to learn more about that one. Maybe you'll get some ideas from each other that way. Okay. So when I go to trainings like this, it's always like big ideas, and it really helps me to contextualize them in like a real life example. So I'm going to give you an example of a referral that I had for something that seemed like some high stakes behaviors that could benefit from a tier three intervention, but ended up responding really, really quickly to tier two. I had a referral for a sixth grade Latino cisgender male general education student in a large middle school in the Seattle area. And he was missing a lot of school. So they had a great attendance staff person whose job was to call home and try to connect with families when kids were missing school. So she was doing her job. Her name was Miss Dorothy, and she would call and try to reach out to the family and the student. And she called pretty often because he was missing a lot. And then at one point, the student said, "If you keep calling my house, I am going to blow up the school." And we know that there's no faster way to get a whole lot of adult attention than making a statement like that. So the assistant principal reached out to me and my team and said, first of all, we need some support with a threat assessment. And second of all, I think there's some other things going on with this kid. Could you help us take a look? So when I came to sort of gather information, because that's often the first step with any of tier two or tier three supports, is you're trying to gather more information. I ended up interviewing the family, the student, touched base with the admin, did a classroom observation, spoke with the teachers, all things that many people on a staff team could have done. And what I figured out when I uncovered some more information is that this boy's father was undocumented. And this was at a time when, you know, the fear of deportation is always high, right? And it was extremely heightened at this period of time. And this student thought that if he missed school, his school would take him to court and his dad would be deported. So the risks to him, his perceived risks, were really, really high. The stakes were very high. And he wasn't a great problem solver. And that's why he made the statement that he made. So just by gathering a little bit more information, we're starting to learn more about the size and scope of the problem and what was going on for him. I did like a brief mental health screening. I am a mental health consultant, so I could look at some nuances of the mental health, but anyone could do a brief screening. And this young person showed up as really high for anxiety. He was a really anxious kid. He had a lot of what you call psychosomatic complaints. So his anxiety showed up with like headaches and stomach aches, things like that. When I observed and gathered more information from the school, he, besides missing school, he had that difficult pattern of that in-school school refusal, where he would sometimes make it to school, but then not reliably make it to class. And when I looked at the pattern of what classes he was most likely to miss, it was his language arts class, and he would hide under the stairway outside his language arts class, which was really sad. And when I did an observation in that classroom, incidentally, that classroom definitely needed some tier one supports, which I recommended to the school admin. I also, through that process, I uncovered a lot of strengths. So this young person loved his honors math teacher, loved his jazz band teacher. His family was really invested in his education. His mom worked in an early childhood school and knew a lot about child development. So a family that was really motivated and open to engaging with the school and partnering. So as I started to help work with the team to develop those tier two supports, we had to start with some data points because it's a data-driven process. So the first data point was easy, just was he coming to school or not? What classes was he attending? We had kind of the baseline data and wanted to see it go up from there. We also wanted to see zero incidents of disciplinary referrals. So no more bomb threats, please. Thank you. And then with our check and connect, which was the tier two intervention we ended up implementing, I customized it a little bit. So this was me pouring some extra ketchup on it to make it work for this student. So because he had the high incident of psychosomatic complaints, he was a kid that you would ask, like, are you kind of an anxious kid? He'd be like, no. But then he'd be like, oh, my heart's racing fast. I'm sweating. I'm dizzy. So we included that as a data point. He had a lot of sleep disturbances. So we included that. We were trying to help the lagging skill we were trying to help support was problem solving and looking to adults as being people that could help him solve problems. So that was included on there as well. So when I worked with the team to pick some tier two interventions off the menu, we ended up being able to pick things that could be implemented really quickly. And we didn't need to slow down and wait for a longer tier three staff intensive, time intensive process. So from sort of like a function based point of view, we could see that he was avoiding language arts. Yes, there were some tier one issues in his language arts class, but he also was avoiding it for some other reasons too. So a tier two intervention we could take off the menu was getting him in language arts class that had some additional support. So we were able to work with the school counselor and get his schedule changed and moved really quickly within like a week. We also did implement check and connect. From my assessment and talking to everyone, we agreed that he seemed really overwhelmed by the move from a small elementary to a really large middle school and sort of bringing that school environment smaller for him and helping him connect more with adults would be helpful. And we used a check and connect with the math teacher at the start and the end of the day in case he didn't make it in the morning, he still had a chance to connect with that adult. And that we could implement also within like a few days. I gave like a mini booster session to the teachers. I developed the form. We were good to go. With parent engagement, the school social worker and the assistant principal and myself, we worked together to do some parent engagement. There's included in the slides and in the resource guide, a guideline for engaging with parents. So we really wanted to bring them alongside of us and partner and kind of moving things forward. And that HAP started immediately. And then with the anxiety part, you know, he was a little hesitant about engaging with like a outpatient mental health provider. That took a little longer to sort of get him on board, but we were able to partner him or match him with a culturally relevant outpatient mental health provider. So what were the effective components here? So you could see from that example that we used cross-disciplinary collaboration to identify the problem and collect data. The attendance person flagged the issue and referred it to the assistant principal, who really correctly identified this as a tier two or three problem versus strictly a disciplinary action. We worked to gather more information and come up with a plan that would work for the student. And following the data collection, the school social worker was positioned to take the lead on delivery of intervention and data collection. So as a school social worker, I was not the one doing the check-in, check-out, but I was helping partner with the family, collect the data, and keep things moving in the right direction. We did select those interventions off the menu, so they were all things that we could implement pretty quickly. So one last plug for school social work. I feel like an infomercial, but I'm not. This is the National Association of School Social Work practice model. And it's just another way to see kind of how a school social worker is trained in unique ways to promote the student well-being, positive school climate across the tiers. So a school social worker in this case I'm referencing really made sense like to be that central spoke in the wheel to help monitor the data and make sure things are implementing, being implemented with fidelity. And once again, if you're interested in learning more about the workforce for student well-being, we're giving away $30,000 conditional scholarships to graduate social work students committed to working in the field of school social work. You can see that link in the resource drive. And I'm going to hand it back to Debbie for our final recap.
Thank you. To review some of the concepts that we discussed today, start with surveying the available resources, use multiple data sources, and begin building with what you have. Remember to make use of what you've got. That will mean standardizing and operationalizing what might have previously been informal practices. And then also it's critical to promote and to train staff about what is on the menu. If they don't know what's on the menu, they can't order off the menu. So, and finally, match intervention to student need. As with Rachel's case study example, one of the most common missteps that we see teams make is that they jump to tier three interventions. And that is using time intensive and time consuming resources when more nimble and less resource heavy tier two practices could provide the needed positive outcomes first. Thank you for coming today. And I think we are going to do a brief question and answer if we have time.
Yeah, we are. But before we do, I hope everybody can give you a round of applause, of silent applause through your reactions buttons. It's great to see some new strategies out there and just ways to organize those strategies as well. So thank you so much for sharing your experiences and your stories today. Yeah, lots of love in the chat. I also want to encourage everybody, if you'd like to ask a question, we are going to have a few minutes for Q&A. So if you want to put them in the Q&A function, that just helps us track which questions people want to ask. And I think we can go to that part. Yeah. Okay. Susan is saying, I would love OSPI to have assessments counselors should use and have them available. And that's an interesting thought there, Susan. I'm wondering a little bit about are you thinking of the assessments as like the screening tools, or maybe you can say more? And I'm not seeing any other open questions.
I have, I can put in the chat, I have a place where I get free screeners that are quick and easy to administer and available in multiple languages, is through the CBT Plus initiative at the University of Washington. It's the CBT Plus notebook. I can try to find it and put it in the Q&A as a response, but that they're all free and they're really easy to use.
Jen is saying, kind of thinking the menu options need to have all students in mind.
Yes, I would certainly agree with that. And I think, you know, when I think about a menu, I think about trying to think of ones that address a lot of different functions of behavior, right? So if you have kids avoiding adult attention versus seeking adult attention, having culturally relevant services that are going to be a match, that's why we want to have a big enough menu that we can pull from things that match to each student. I'm glad the menu metaphor worked because it made sense in our heads, but we weren't sure it would fly. Had to hear it work for folks.
And also to remember that those items on the menu can be adapted for students. You can pour ketchup on, you can use diverse communication strategies, just not significantly changed into resource heavy supports.
Someone in the chat has asked, can you describe effective ways you've seen districts use and provide professional development around restorative practices? Do you have any experience with that?
Can you repeat the question? I was distracted by the chat.
Oh, okay. Can you describe some ways that your district has used or provided professional development around restorative practices? Is that part of your menu?
I most recently came from a large school district that was implementing some restorative practices at every level. So they were having like larger sort of restorative conversations with school teams sort of post-crisis and with families and students. And then they were trying to implement restorative practices as like an alternative to exclusionary disciplinary practices. And I was trained in some of that, but I wasn't part of the team delivering the restorative practices. But yes, that could certainly be, I think, within the realm of a tier two intervention for staff teams to consider.
We have one more question. I think this will be the last one from Q&A. Do you have a document that specifically outlines customized instead of individualized supports?
That's a great question. I think, I don't know that we have a document that says that. I think, I don't know, Debbie, do you have any thoughts on that one?
I think it's coming back to that menu idea. And if it's an option that with some standardization could be provided to any student, or then it kind of is available on that tier two menu. When you're looking into very specific and individualized professional support or support from someone with, you know, highly trained in something very specific, then you're getting into that more advanced tier three intervention. But we don't have a document.
Or if you go to that like check-in, check-out example I showed, that was customized. So it was like, we have still the check-in, check-out off the menu, but we just added a little bit. Versus like I had another student at that school that needed much more individualized one-on-one staff attention, like multiple check-ins during the day with very specific incentive plans involving fake eyelashes and makeup that were specific to her and her needs, that took a lot more time and energy to implement versus like just making some quick changes. So where the exact line is a good question. I'd have to think about that.
Nice. Thank you, everybody. I think we're going to move on to our panel discussion. So we like to incorporate people who are out there doing the work and be able to hear from them. So today we have a panel that includes Erika Aldridge. She is a school counselor at Allen Elementary. It's a K-8 school in Bow, Washington. This is her third year as a school counselor. Before becoming a school counselor, she was a high school math teacher at Oak Harbor High School. We also have with us Laycee Weier, a school social worker at Chief Joseph Middle School, where she also attended in the Richland School District. Laycee has been a social worker for 16 years and a school social worker for 3 years. She's also been involved in educational social work for over 12 years as an educational advocate for youth in foster care. And we also have with us Nicholas French. He's a director of teaching and learning and special services in the Ocosta School District in Westport, Washington. He uses his education and experience in special education, intervention, and evidence-based practices to create inclusive school systems that promote high student learning. So welcome, panel. And I'm gonna end your videos so I can do that. And yeah, you should all be, sorry, there we go. I'm gonna stop sharing these slides for a moment. So Nick, I'd like to start with you actually, because I think as a district leader, you have kind of a unique perspective on how to carve out time for tier two work and how to support it at the district level. Do you want to talk a little bit about what that looks like?
Yes, I'd be happy to. First off and foremost is you have to get it in your master schedules. You have to put that as, and as an administrator, the master schedule is your strongest tool to promote change around systems. And so having scheduled time for interventions creates a culture that starts to think about interventions because it's on their schedule. And then how you use that time can evolve as you get better at it. But our high school last year did a no new work Friday. So every period on Fridays was intervention time. They have modified it this year to do something a little different because there's some specific needs they're trying to get at, but they still have that scheduled intervention time. Elementary school has at least 30 minutes daily in classroom schedules. And then there's a number of things that go on depending on students' needs. But overall, you know, how do you get time for tier two? You make it mandatory in school schedules. And then that gives people space and time to prepare and also think about what you're going to be doing because it's seen as part of their classroom routine. And we talk about finishing the learning versus providing an intervention, right? I mean, it is an intervention time, but really what we're doing is guaranteeing they learn what we think is important. And that can vary by grade or by content area. And the tools we use to do that are our interventions, but it's not additional work, it's completing the work. And I think it's important how you talk about intervention from the district level or from the building principal level. You have to be intentional about how you speak about it, and the expectations around it have to be manageable for all staff. So for my role as the district office, I have, I take on interventions from the loose and tight perspective. There's things I'm very tight about, and there's things that I'm loose about when it comes to doing interventions. So things that I'm tight about, standard forms and procedures. And I'm tight about that because the reason inequities in the system are what causing gaps in learning. And so the only way to address inequities in a systemic way is to place a new system in place of it or that enhances it. So, and you start that by standardization of forms and processes. These forms and processes are flexible enough to meet local needs, but the process and the form are non-negotiable for me. And I will, you know, I've been known to review them and give feedback and support with completing those forms appropriately. So that's a big one for me. We have a real high visual point for attendance in our systems because attendance is, you can't help other areas of academics or social emotional if they're not coming to school enough to benefit from the intervention. And as a side note, Washington is a leader in the nation in chronic absenteeism. And so it is fundamentally part of our culture of low attendance in the state of Washington pre-COVID. I'll say that even pre-COVID. So it's only been impacted more. And so if you're not looking at attendance as an instructional or social well-being intervention, you're missing probably the predominant issue with most of the kids that are being sent your way. They have to be at school to learn, and that's academics and well-being interventions. I do a lot of coaching of staff. I expect data to be used and collected. That is also a non-negotiable. It has to be present or it's back to the drawing board. I talk about meeting kids' needs first and figuring out what the tier is later. I don't want folks to get caught up in checking a box or selecting the wrong intervention because of what's on the paper in front of them versus what the kid needs. And so that's important for me. And then I also provide schools with basic resources of, like, you know, a binder, for lack of a better term. These are well-being behavioral interventions that are evidence-based from the clearinghouse. Here are academic interventions that are can be applied to every content area, right? So they have a base of skills and knowledge that they can look through as they're working. I take the responsibility to do that. They are the same for all buildings. They all have the same information to start with. Things I'm loose on, selection of interventions. I trust teachers. I trust teams. Frequency of meetings. My only note on that is meet to get through your list of kids. But how you meet, when you meet, they know the building, the schedules better than I. Who makes up the team? I'm really not too awfully concerned about that, because you need people who want to do the work. And sometimes that's not the people you think it should be. And so I really give latitude to my principals and their teams of picking the team. Trainings. I give some basic trainings throughout the year about how specifically, like, how special ed, 504, and tiered intervention teams work together. So that broader child find obligation we have for all those programs, I train on that and sort of the uniqueness of each program and how they interact. But I allow them to come to me and offer, like, we would like more information on X. Great. You're vested. You want to know more. That's important. We'll help you with that. Some well-being interventions we do specific to what we were discussing today. We're using the Center of Educational Effectiveness Student Well-Being Survey for the first time this year, which is a pre and post survey. So we'll do one pre-winter break and then at the end of the school year. What's unique about this survey is it also asks direct questions of kids and if they need help immediately. And it produces a notice to us that and the kid's name. So we, do you need food? Is your housing on? It has some basic instant response questions that we can respond to. So we're excited about that. Our school counselors and school psychologists engage in counseling, one-on-one, small group. We do check-in, check-out. One of the more novel things we use is the MITRE program, a de-escalation prevention intervention. That's biometrics, Children's Hospital, Harvard University. I put their website in the link. It is a fantastic. I have general ed teachers who say he's taking deep breaths in class because he's learned it through this interactive gamified biometric system. I've never seen kids react faster to a regulation training. So I highly recommend it. It's extremely affordable for schools. And then finally, I have interactions with social workers from another state. And so I thought I'd just throw my two cents in. There's a graphic that is part of the packet that you can find, but I really look at social workers as students to home, while counselors are students to the school system. All the work that you'll see on this form is happening, whether you have all these people, needs to happen, whether you have all these people or not. It's how do you delegate and resource to meet the needs. But as that's how I sort of, when I think about the school, and this is an excerpt from Missouri Public School Systems, how they sort of categorize and group psychologists, counselors, and social workers. So that is my bit. I don't want to take up too much time, but I'm happy to answer questions at the end or whenever works well for the presentation.
People are wondering, what's the survey that you're using?
It's this week. So we do the every year, every other year, we do the Center of Educational Effectiveness. They're a group out of Bellevue, and they have a survey that ties to the 9 characteristics of effective schools. They've since added on an additional survey you can do that is a well-being survey. And I don't know the name of it specifically. I think it's the first year they've had this, but you can find it on their website. And they go by CEE sometimes as well as an acronym.
Awesome. Well, let's hear from Laycee and Erika too. I want to make sure that we get over there. And Laycee, you're a school social worker. What do you think, what are the tier two practices and interventions that you're relying on?
Oh, yeah. Okay. Thank you for having me. I'm happy to be here. This is really exciting. And I also want to echo what Rachel had said earlier. We need more school social workers. Please hire them in your districts. So for tier two interventions, can I first say why I love being a social worker in my district?
Yeah, okay. Sure.
Okay. So first, I really want to tell you why I love being a social worker in my district in Richland, Washington. You know, school social workers, of course, you know, serve mental health needs of students and families, and provide crisis intervention, of course. But we also, you know, meet twice a year in what is called the four pillars, which is all ESAs working really closely together for students and families. And you can show that slide if you have a chance. The four pillars is our social workers, nurses, school psychs, and counselors working together. I think there's a different slide, Kefi. Not that one. Sorry.
That one.
There we go. Okay, great. So it kind of shows the difference between all the things that we do and how we closely work together in that MTSS system. I think the big thing that's really important and why I love doing this is that I feel like interconnected systems really has such an important impact on families and on students. And without these four pillars working together, we're not doing everything we can for students in their best interest. So it's really a full wraparound. You know, working with all of these professionals and in this setting has really made me a better social worker and really just a better human being. And I really wanted to say that because they are amazing people with a wealth of knowledge. I waited a long time for this position to come available because it needed to be created. And so that's why I echo, please definitely hire school social workers in your district. So tier two examples, things that work. So people have brought this up before, check in, check out is really helpful for our high risk learners. We do that every day. Implementation of our PBIS system, data collection through surveys. Sometimes we make surveys up to get information that we need, like family engagement surveys. What could be, like, for instance, for our back to school night in September, I sent out a survey to all of our families and just said, what are your biggest needs? Do you need food? Do you need housing support? What do you need? And I will get to the biomass four pillars model. I'll get to that, I promise. I just saw that in the chat. It's really helpful. We sent out a survey to try to get families engaged, you know, obviously healthy youth, and then biomass, which is a survey, and I'll get into that in a minute. We also do home visits weekly. We're really religious about that at our school, making sure that we are actually going to the homes for attendance issues, anything else, and really meeting and shaking hands with parents. That is so huge. And a game changer in how we do the supports in our schools. We also do attendance contracts. It's really important to get our kids to school. And I'm echoing what Nick had said, it is an unfortunate reality in Washington State that we do have such bad attendance. So we're trying to work on that. I also do social groups. I do those throughout the week. I have seven different groups that I run, sixth, seventh, and eighth grade. In those groups, I'm providing executive functioning skills, coping skills. We do different groups that run. Those groups that I just talked about are all year round. We also do other groups that are shorter term, which are 6 to 8 weeks. Those are for students that are have families that are incarcerated. Maybe there's anxiety and depression happening. Maybe there's suicide ality happening. Maybe there's all sorts of things. And so we put together groups to support our students and do that once a week. We pull them out of an elective for an hour, parent permission. And I cannot tell you how well that has worked out for our school. Our kids feel seen and heard and loved through those group processes. And it just means an awful lot. And then the other one that we do is the biomass. So let me get into that because that's a bit more. So it's about 2021, I believe, that the district had implemented this, which it's a screening tool. It's a social emotional screening assessment that's done twice per year. It stands for Behavior Monitoring Assessment System. Parents can opt kids out, but we believe it's preventative and an early intervention model. Like I said, it was implemented in 2021 due to massive supports for our district mental health. We had quite a few suicides that year and throughout, and it just really was something that the district was passionate about and decided to put this in place so that we could survey students and find out where they're at with their mental health. So there's quite a few things that are involved in that. It gives us data and supports that are needed, and we respond in real time, which is really, really important. There's about 31 to 34 questions, depending on if you're a student, a parent, or an educator who's taking it. The questions access basically behaviorally related student conduct, anxiety and depression, attention and focus, communication and relationships, and then academic functioning. It takes 5 to 10 minutes to complete. And then what we do at the end of it is we provide an exit ticket, which is just a piece of paper. And all they have to do is say, it has a couple of questions on it. Do you have a trusted adult in the building? Right. If they don't, then we're following up with them and we are rebuilding rapport with that student. So I'm really proud to work for the Richland School District because of how much work is being done to spotlight our students' mental health. It's so hard to do academics when you are so depressed, you're thinking about taking your life, right? So we want to make sure mental health is a huge priority. And I definitely feel like it is in our district and I know in other districts too. So that's what we do with tier two.
Awesome. And Laycee, someone's asked in the Q&A, do you have a specific curriculum for your small groups in the middle school, or what does that look like?
That's a really great question. I have some curriculums that I use, but otherwise it's me and I kind of make it up on my own through my professional opinions and my education and all the things that I've done previously to this job that I know have worked. So for me, I just sort of make it up, and maybe I should, get it published to make some money. I don't know, but
Erika, I want to make sure we spend a little time on you too. You're a school counselor, and you've been partnering with school social workers. What does that partnership look like? And do you have any pointers for people who want to see that expanded?
Yeah, sure. Thanks. Thanks again for having me for this opportunity. Like Laycee, I love school social workers. I feel really fortunate. As a full-time school counselor, I have a full-time school social worker to partner with. And I know that some schools don't have that same opportunity. I encourage you to advocate for that, especially within your tiered systems of support. So the way it works for us in the tiered system, it's really taking a look at what our skill set is and what our strengths are between me and my partner, social worker, and then seeing what are our school needs and where does that fit best. And for us, it tends to fit where I'm working more in tier one and tier two. We overlap a lot in tier two. And then she's working more intensely in tier three with her skill set and experiences. But like was mentioned in the presentation, we work in all tiers. But that's kind of where we prioritize our work and where our skill sets lie. It is a great partnership for consultation and collaboration. We work really closely together, constantly. Trying to improve our work and discuss clients and how best to support them. And so that's kind of my quick answer on our partnership and how that works best.
Awesome. Yeah, I love that. I had never thought about like the connection point of school counselors and school social workers and the intensity of like a tier three support meeting the needs in tier two also. And so how do you look at like a student as a whole child and as their life is like, what do they need to make it there and to be successful? And I think that it really does take a lot of like thoughtful teaming to make that happen. And how lucky to have a school social worker to ask about those things. I think a lot of times in schools, they're almost like, off, you know, like that's a home thing. That's not a school thing is kind of a common mindset.
Yeah.
We are almost out of time. So I'm going to share. Laycee had the slide, and you can take a look at it in the slide deck if you want to as well. It just kind of lists out some of their practices and programs at each tier level. So I know some people are interested in examples, and if that's you, check that out. Of course, we want to make sure that our conversation doesn't end here. We hope that you've been inspired by something you've heard today and that you can take it back to your school team or to your PLC, your leadership, maybe even some students, and see what they think as well. There are funding opportunities for this work. So just wanted you to be aware there's Title IVA funding as an option if you're interested in that. We do have an engaged newsletter each month, and this month we focused on this topic. So if you want more information on it, Rachel wrote us an awesome article. We also have leadership activities if you're looking for something to do at your staff meeting that offers some opportunities there. And I believe, Erika, is this your ClassPass document and your check-in, check-out document? Do you want to talk about that briefly?
Oh, sure. Yeah, those probably are. Yes. So for our check-in, check-out, I think it was mentioned earlier about keeping in it within the tier two, keeping those documents more uniform for all students. So our check-in, check-out is a document. We have one developed for K2. One for 3-5 and one for 6-8. And we keep those pretty uniform for any student that's on check-in, check-out. And then if a student needs more support and receives tier three services, then we might modify it. Awesome. So that is we just have our three school expectations: be responsible, be safe, be kind. And then maybe 4 to 8 times throughout the day where you check in with them to give them feedback on whether they're meeting those expectations. And it's based on how many reminders do you have to give them to be responsible, right? If they need 0 to 1 reminders, then they earn 2 points for that little time period for being responsible. Do they need 2 to 4 reminders? Then they get 1 point. And if they need more than 4 reminders, they earn a 0. So that's a part of it with the constant feedback from teacher. There's also a beginning check-in with another adult in the school, giving them the form, reminding them, have a great day, remember your goals, and then checking out at the end of the day. Oh, what a great job you did. Look at, why'd you get this 2? That's amazing. What'd you do? Here's a 0. Looks like tomorrow's a new day. We get a fresh start. All those like positive, encouraging words. And then ClassPass is intervention too for students with more internalizing behaviors, maybe that might need a break from the classroom setting. And it is a set number of passes that you give a student each day and they decide when they need to use it. There's a preset location where they take that break with adult supervision. And then there's more that goes along with it, but I know we're almost out of time. So
awesome. Thanks, Erika.
Yeah.
If you want those resources, they are linked in our resource sheet. So just know that it's available. And we also have that BIMAS website if you're interested in checking that out, as well as the University of Washington School of Social Work, Check and Connect, including some parent involvement links are there and available. And of course, the OSPI Youth Suicide Prevention, Intervention, and Postvention site is available. So check those out. They're full of great resources. You can always connect with our staff, and our email addresses are in the presentation and our resource sheet as well. So please don't be shy about contacting us with additional questions that you've got. And that's it for, I think, this week. Next month, we are going to be talking about organizational wellness for equity. If you are interested in school-wide wellness and what does it look like at a district level to do that kind of work, we are going to be talking about that this next month, and I hope you'll invite colleagues who would be interested as well. We have a poll for our evaluation, and I'm going to launch that right now. Our poll, we use your feedback every month, and we look at your evaluations. And when the webinar closes out, we have kind of a longer form evaluation thing that just helps us know what topics you're interested in and that kind of stuff. So if you can take the time to answer the questions, it should take you under 5 minutes, I think. And if you are here for clock hours, we'd love to see you get some. If you join live, you're already registered for the year through Zoom, so you'll get reminders each month to join. You'll also need to register for clock hours monthly in pdEnroller. pdEnroller is going to send you an evaluation from them to your email, and that is going to be how we verify attendance and we release your hours. If you're watching this video later, the process changes a little bit. You register each month for clock hours in pdEnroller still, and you complete the evaluation, and you'll also do our graduation equity feedback survey. And that just signals to us that you watched the video, and it kind of pings us so that we can verify your attendance that way. And if you have questions about this, Ronnie Larson's awesome. She does our clock hour support, and she is happy to help you. Thanks again for joining us, and we will see you next month.